Your Excellency, Ambassador of Armenia to France, Madame Hasmik Tolmajan, Your Excellencies, Members of the European Parliament and the Parliament of France, Honorable Members of the Armenian National Committee of France, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen from France and Armenia, dear friends, it is a great honor and privilege for me to be here with you today among so many dedicated and professional friends to address my speech on a number of vital issues related to the rights of my nation and my sacred motherland. It is of utmost importance to address to you in my capacity as the human rights defender of the Republic of Armenia. Armenia's Human Rights Ombudsman is an independent official, leading the only human rights institution in Armenia. It is independent from the government, non-political, strong, and trusted institution with a broad constitutional mandate to protect and promote human rights. It is mandated not only support individuals affected by the conflict, but also to promote the culture of rights. The institution addresses full range of human rights, including civil, political, economic, social, and cultural rights. The Constitution of Armenia guarantees everyone's right to receive assistance of the human rights defender in the event of violation of their rights and freedoms. This is an absolute right and cannot be subject to limitations. Armenia's human rights defender is accredited with the internationally approved highest quality label. This is the A status of the institution as official recognition of its full compliance with the United Nations Paris principles and other international norms. Acting in this capacity as the human rights defender of Armenia, I came across widespread and gross violations of human rights that any institution of such type would ever deal with. This unprecedented experience of observing and investigating human rights violations and severe war crimes started to massively evolve since September 2020. And continues up to now as a result of Azerbaijani aggression against Armenia and Artsakh. The aggression that hit hard the population of both Armenia and Artsakh, resulting in ethnic cleansings. On Sunday, September 27, 2020, all Armenians in the world woke up to the news that the Azerbaijani armed forces had launched a large-scale offensive along the entire line of contact with Artsakh. On this specific day, the offensive by the Azerbaijani army was accompanied by artillery shelling and airstrikes targeting civilian objects and civilian population. In particular, on this very day, the capital Stepanakert, Martuni and Martakert, and other communities came under fire. As a result of shelling, civilians of Martuni city were killed and many civilians of the same city were injured. The population of peaceful communities was forced to take shelters in bunkers. The 44-day disastrous war started. Azerbaijan, with Turkey's full military support and accompanied by state-sponsored hatred and enmity, massive torture and inhuman treatment, destructed the civilian communities through targeted shelling, use of prohibited cluster warhead missiles, participation of trafficked jihadist mercenaries and terrorists. From the first moments of the bloody war, the Human Rights Defender of Armenia, in close cooperation with the Human Rights Ombudsman of Artsakh, started 24 hours monitoring and large-scale investigations, on-site visits to civilian communities, work with worldwide international organizations. During the active phase of hostilities and aftermath, civilians were killed and injured due to the indiscriminate and deliberate attacks of the Azerbaijani forces towards the civilian communities and civilian vital infrastructures, both in Artsakh and Armenia. Thousands of people lost their properties, houses, vehicles, plots of land, livestock. They were either damaged and destroyed by indiscriminate and deliberate attacks or fell under the control of Azerbaijani authorities. Tens of thousands of individuals were forced to leave their communities due to threat to their lives as a result of Azerbaijani offensive. Very often families were separated to be able to find a place to live. This war was accompanied by massive amount of torture and inhuman treatment of Armenian servicemen and civilians captured by Azerbaijani armed forces. With the war expanding, the number of cases and the level of cruelty demonstrated by the Azerbaijani military had dramatically expanded, which is also evident from the volume of visual and audio files disseminated online. Atrocities and cruelties committed by the Azerbaijani armed servicemen were widely disseminated through the Azerbaijani social network media, Telegram, Instagram, Facebook, and more. These videos of extreme violence were specifically targeting Armenian social media, including children, women, and elderly. By this, massively spreading scenes of violence and causing sufferings to the Armenian society, playing with the emotions of families and the population in general. In many cases, videos or photos were sent to families of victims. Fact-finding missions of Armenia's Human Rights Defender have revealed about 400 video and photo materials of torture and humiliations, executions, beheadings alive, mutilation of bodies of Armenian servicemen and civilians by the Azerbaijani armed forces. The border civilian population in Armenia and Artsakh has been hit hard by human rights violations after the war too. In case of Armenia, in the absence of delimitation and demarcation, the border determination process of Armenia with Azerbaijan is being carried out through massive human rights violations in the context of Azerbaijani genocidal policy and under threats of war against Armenia and its entire population, as well as Artsakh. Immediately after the cessation of hostilities, from November 2020, armed Azerbaijani servicemen, Azerbaijani signs and flags appeared in the immediate vicinity of Armenia's Syunik and Gegharkunik province villages, as well as on the roads between civilian communities of Syunik. The Human Rights Defender of Armenia launched immediate fact-finding missions to these border communities. Urgent monitoring and investigation proceedings have been launched. The visits and launched investigations clearly established that the Azerbaijani armed servicemen forced civilians to leave their lands and houses that have belonged to them in many cases since even before the Soviet times. In November and December 2020, they threatened to destroy their villages and houses through UAV attacks, drone attacks, if civilians refused to leave their communities, for instance, Vorotan village, Aravus village, and more. Along with protection of peaceful life and security of people, the right to freedom of movement has been violated because of Azerbaijani armed servicemen's block posts on the roads between communities of Syunik. Various sections of the interstate road from Goris to Kapan and from Kapan city to Chakaten and several other villages have come under Azerbaijani control. This has put the movement of civilians in real danger and has already created problems affecting the rights of the border population, including by creating humanitarian crisis situations for the local population of surrounding villages. On August 25, more than 50 Azerbaijani servicemen blocked the interstate road leading from Goris to Kapan near Davidbek village for 2 days. On August 26, Azerbaijani armed servicemen blocked the road from Goris Kapan near Vorotan village, which was the second section. By blocking the mentioned sections of the road, Azerbaijani armed servicemen intentionally created a humanitarian crisis for several Armenian villages. These villages had been left in blockade for several days. Since November 11 and November 15, Azerbaijani so-called border control and customs checkpoints were installed on the roads between communities of Syunik province, on the roads Goris-Kapan and Kapan-Chakaten. Enormous social problems occurred in addition to security issues. Socio-economic rights in Syunik and in Gegharkunik provinces remain grossly violated. People are deprived of their properties, even with legal documentation certifying their rights over these properties, with no compensation. Significant number of persons still continue to pay credits for the lost properties. Losses and damages caused to local population have not been counted. No inventory was carried out due to the genocidal policy and threats of new war. Azerbaijani incursions of May 2021 into the sovereign territories of Armenia, Syunik and Gegharkunik provinces intensified human rights violations and took massive and gross forms, shootings toward civilian communities, setting massive fires near villages and more. The Human Rights Defender monitoring revealed a new case of incursion which took place in October 2020 within Kapan community, not far from Tsav village, a real security issue and property violations. In addition to all the above mentioned violations, the Azerbaijani authorities continue causing sufferings to the Armenian population by illegally keeping our compatriots as captives, civilians and military servicemen. In absolute violation of the international humanitarian law, instead of immediate release and repatriation, Azerbaijani authorities keep them under torture and direct threats to their lives. They have launched so-called investigations and artificial trials against Armenian captives, using them for political and military bargaining purposes. Evidence confirms that the Azerbaijani state-sponsored policy of hatred has become the root cause, the real root cause, of massive human rights violations and ethnically motivated crimes, not only in the region, but also globally. Very recently, I had the chance to visit the United States of America, and in particular, the city of San Francisco. At the assistance of Armenian National Committee of America, we have visited the Armenian school, which was vandalized during the war by Azerbaijani paramilitary groups, and the Armenian church, which was set on fire by Azerbaijanis during the war. Evidence confirmed that the same situation occurred also in France when there were attacks from Azerbaijani Turkish paramilitary criminal groups against Armenians. Here I want to express my deep gratitude to His Excellency Ambassador Jonathan Lacote, who was the ambassador of France to Armenia. And I had the chance to be every day in contact with Honorable Ambassador related to all these issues. And I'm deeply grateful to the Ambassador for paying close attention to these issues, especially on giving the chance to the Human Rights Defender to declare during the meeting with him that the French government put a ban on the grey wolves. These are vivid examples how the Azerbaijani state-sponsored policy of hatred and animosity propaganda can affect other countries, their human rights systems, democratic institutions, and stability. This important factor must be brought to the attention of the countries that created the current system of international law, more specifically, the international human rights law, and continue to advocate for it. Armenians have experienced ethnic hatred and countless persecutions. They have been subjected to genocidal massacres and pogroms. This experience continues to this day. In the post-war context, it is experiencing new forms and developments. The president of Azerbaijan actively leads this practice. He routinely uses derogatory terms to collectively describe Armenians, referring to them as, I quote, bandits, vandals, fascists, barbarians, and as having cowardly nature, people without brain. He also consistently denies the occurrence of the Armenian genocide and all the recognitions. Recently, he started to attack the Armenian diaspora, claiming that Armenians are poisoned with poison. I quote, "This poison mainly comes from their diaspora, which sits in a very quiet and nice places in southern France, in California, in Krasnodar Krai, in some other capitals, and enjoy their life. And they want those Armenians in Nagorno-Karabakh and in Armenia to be their hostages and be their tools for them to pursue some ambitious and chauvinistic ideas." This is the manifestation of an ingrained hatred of Armenians that finds expression also in the media and education system. Consistent with the policy of ethnic cleansing and rhetoric of hate, as noted above, Azerbaijan has historically committed countless violations of international law, majority of which were plainly racially motivated. Azerbaijan's propagation of hate against Armenians has manifested itself in the condoning, rewarding, and even glorifying crimes against Armenians. In keeping with its long-standing policy of ethnic cleansing, Azerbaijan has also systematically sought to destroy, erase, and falsely Armenian cultural heritage in the region. This policy is being aggressively carried out in Artsakh nowadays. As a result of military aggression against Artsakh, at least 1,456 overwhelmingly Armenian historical and cultural prominent immovable monuments, including 161 monasteries and churches, 591 khachkars, cross stones, the ancient sites of Tigranakert, Azokh, Nor Karmiravan, Mirik, Keren, fortresses and castles and other monuments remained under the control of Azerbaijan. The deplorable history of persecution of Armenians in the region dates back centuries. The contemporary policies of discrimination against ethnic Armenians, which are an inalienable part of the life within the Republic of Azerbaijan, are rooted in developments in the early 20th century and are linked directly with the genocidal policies of the Ottoman Empire. Our compatriots living in Armenia and Artsakh experienced the same threats and difficulties as our grandparents and parents went through in the Ottoman Empire. The ongoing state-sponsored Azerbaijani policy of Armenophobia and hatred is the source for above-mentioned disastrous consequences. We have to learn lessons, recognize threats, and act accordingly. How we can overcome all these difficulties and challenges, whether it is possible, and whether we can do it. Yes, we can. We have to act in unity and solidarity more than ever. Our strategy should be our joint efforts to ensure the long-standing peace and security of our sacred motherland and our nation. We ourselves are the guarantors of our rights and secure future. I want to express of my regret for international organizations being silent throughout the war and for allowing politics and politicians to prevail over human rights and humanitarian consequences of the disastrous war. Here I want to express my deep gratitude to the people of France and to the state of France for showing their true dedication to human rights and democratic values. I want to express my deep respect to the Armenian National Committee of France for the whole team, for their tremendous work and tireless efforts in protection of rights of Armenian people in the diaspora, Armenia and Artsakh. Thank you all for being with us all along the way. We have many seeds to plant along the path. We won't reach our destination in one day, but I know we can get there. We shall never give up, never retreat. We have no choice but to accomplish our historical mission to protect our own rights, to create strong safeguards for these rights. This will lead us to a new progress, relying on our own wisdom. Thank you very much for your attention.